Welcome to Best Practices, Ways to Make Nature's Benefits Communications Resonate with External Stakeholders. This is the third webinar in the Nature's Benefits Forum series. We're happy you could join us today. I'm Christiana Tighe-Witherell with Willamette Partnership. We're a nonprofit based in Portland, Oregon, and we help build the collaborative spaces and tools that groups need to make better natural resource decisions, laying the groundwork for more effective conservation. The Nature's Benefits Forum webinar series is an online workshop to help Forest Service staff and external partners understand the value Nature's Benefits communications can have in connecting forest restoration efforts with people and communities, why that matters, and how to do it. Today's webinar is the third in our series, and we're going to learn how to make Nature's Benefits communications resonate with stakeholders. We'll hear from both Forest Service staff and external partners about what's working for them, and what response they're seeing from stakeholders. And with that, I'd like to welcome Will Harling with the Western Klamath Restoration Partnership. He's the Director of Fisheries, Fire, and Fuels for the Mid-Klamath Watershed Council. Welcome, Will.
Thank you, Christiana. And I'm excited to have this time to talk about how we've been addressing nature's benefits through the Western Klamath Restoration Partnership. This, as you can see in this opening slide, we're from a very mountainous region in far northern California that has been in the crosshairs of mega fires for the past 30 plus years. So, you know, we've had to engage in fire in a really meaningful way in that time, and it has become, you know, part of who we are and how we relate to the land. And so a lot of the work we've done as far as nature's benefits is in regards to fire. You can go to the next slide. So this, you can see the map here is where we're at on the landscape. It's a 1.2 million acre landscape just south of the Oregon border along the Klamath River. It includes also includes the entire Salmon River drainage. Just a little history, you know, we were in the middle of the timber wars for 20 years with really contentious arguments between environmentalists and industry. And luckily in 2013, we were able to bring the Nature Conservancy in to facilitate meetings with this large group of stakeholders over the course of several years to help us realize our commonalities. Next, you can go advance. So just this is a quick snapshot of our landscape. It's primarily within national forest ownership, and it's also mostly part of the Karuk Aboriginal Territory. And so obviously the Forest Service is our main partner, but we do have private lands sprinkled throughout as well as the three largest Native American tribes in California located in our vicinity. Next. So I think one of the things that's different about our landscape is that there is this very deep tie to the cultural uses of the landscape. And as you can see in these pictures, you know, these are just some of the resources that the Karuk tribe and their descendants rely upon to this day, you know, from the hazel to make baskets to the huckleberries and the acorns that people still use as food sources to the salmon that come up the river every year. You know, these are real and present direct benefits from nature. And so for us, I think it's a little bit easier to connect with our external stakeholders in the sense that most people still have these direct connections to the landscape, either feeding them or providing them resources like firewood to live. Next. So one of the keys to our process, we went through the open standards process for conservation when we first convened the Western Klamath Restoration Partnership. And one of the beauties of that model is that we came together around what we shared, what values we shared, and not what we disagreed on. And that's a huge point, because too often people, you know, go right back to the things they've been fighting out through the decades. And so for us, you know, this process of talking about all the things that we agreed upon, that we cared about, these shared values. I see, sorry, Sherry, my connection is shaky, and I'm on a satellite internet connection here out in the middle of nowhere. So hopefully you're catching most of what I'm saying. So those shared values were sustainable local economies, cultural and community vitality, fire adapted communities, restored fire regimes, resilient biodiverse forests, plants, animals, fish, and a healthy river system. Next slide. And so one of the things that we did that was really effective was we took all these values and then we went out and looked at different data sources that represented those shared values. And in total, we came up with 24 different geographic, you know, shape files and GIS, geographic information systems, that we could overlay on the landscapes to represent all the values of our diverse stakeholders. And a lot of those did tie to specific benefits from nature, whether it was, you know, deer and elk habitat, to, you know, the timber resources, which we represented as the mid-mature dense fir stands, you know, those places where we had, you know, fir stands that were, you know, potentially viable for the timber industry, but were in places where they shouldn't ecologically be. And so through all these layers, we were able to keep those partners, those diverse partners, engaged by showing that their values were being represented on our landscape. And so you can see this product that we created through the Fire Adapted Communities Learning Network to demonstrate this work, and I'd be happy to make this available. But it showed us where we needed to go together on this 1.2 million acre landscape to do that work first to achieve our shared values. Next slide. So some of those things that were part of that, what we called the zones of agreement, which is where we wanted to look first to do that work, are listed here on the left. But I do want to just, you know, get you guys to look at this landscape, which is, this is along the Klamath River, where the community of Orleans is kind of in the lower center, with the Salmon River coming in on the right, with, you know, steep mountain ranges all around. But what started to come out of this, you know, this look into what our values look like when we put them on the landscape was really a way for us to restore fire process on this landscape. And Christiana, if you can advance it one more time, you can see, you know, just a visual representation of some of these resources, you know, from salmon, which, you know, we're holding on to our salmon runs here in the Klamath River, to elk, which, you know, there are people come here from all around the world to hunt for elk, to food and fiber resources, to fire protection, to all of these fire adapted habitats that we're trying to bring back to protect our communities. You know, all of these things come together to help tell a story for how we're gonna, as a community, restore fire process on our landscape. So that's about all I had. Feel free to reach out. We're really excited about the work that we're doing here on the Western Klamath Restoration Partnership Landscape. We just submitted a $40 million Collaborative Forest Landscape Restoration Act proposal that we're hoping they return funding to here in the next year, so we can really start to implement this work at scale.
Thank you, Will. We're going to move directly into our next presentation. So if you have questions for Will, please put them into the chat box. I'd like to welcome Johan Hogervorst, forest hydrologist with the Willamette National Forest. Welcome, Johan.
Thanks, Christiana. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so I'm going to give you a case study example from 2012 that I was involved with on the Willamette National Forest. So in that year, Karen Bennett, who at the time was our regional soil scientist in Region 6, Oregon and Washington, she came to myself and others on the Willamette and said, I'd really like to pick a project area, do an all lands collaborative restoration planning approach, and use a design charrette process. And I want to do this with a Forest Service interdisciplinary team. In a decade past, I had worked with Karen on the Siuslaw National Forest. We had used the design charrette approach. It had worked well to characterize essentially all the known information about an area and then come up with a restoration plan. And so she wanted to try it with an interdisciplinary team in the Forest Service. And that's what we did. Slide. So this is Soda Fork Creek. It's a sub-watershed, sixth field sub-watershed. If you squint, you can see the different colors there. There's green for Forest Service and white for private industrial land. So it is an kind of a mixed ownership area. There is the Menagerie Wilderness off to the left there. This is the west slope of the Cascades, so very good timber growing ground. We also have anadromous fish. We have Chinook and winter steelhead, primarily winter steelhead in this area. And this is also quite close to the small rural community of Sweet Home, and the community likes to drive through here and cut firewood and spend time in this little sub-watershed. Slide. So for this process, we had a core team of mostly district specialists at the Sweet Home Ranger District with a couple of forest level folks mixed in, and I was one of those forest level folks. And then if you look at the second list there, the CTC core team, that was the private industrial landowner, Cascade Timber Consultants, and Dave Furtwängler is the president of that management company. And so we were very honored to have him involved in this process. Slide. So this design charrette process, I'll explain a little more about what that means, but we designated our project area, our lead facilitator, I was one of those. And then I want to draw your attention to number two there, the knowledge transfer. And the idea behind this is to have your core team just be inundated with as much expertise and knowledge and information about this portion of the West Cascades, and particularly there, the Soda Fork drainage. So over a 5-day period in both the office and the field, we had specialists come in and just talk to us about what they knew for this area. And the beauty of that is that your whole team learns all the resources for that particular area and helps inform what you're working on. The end of that process, there number five is a graphic report with a set of projects and a design to carry forward. Slide. So quickly, here's the community of interest. We had local city folks, county, state, university interest, tribes, and then at the bottom, some special interest groups on both the environmental side and the hunting and timber side, and then also members of the general public, particularly from the local community. Next. So we had a series of these collaborative pinups, and this design charrette process comes out of French architectural studios. They used to have students roll their designs into a room and share those designs with a community of interest. The community would then give feedback and critique. They would roll it back into their studio and work on it some more, come back out, repeat the process. So the iterative process really does two things. It creates a really strong design, but it also just kind of that community of interest really invests in it and they put their values into it. So you have that kind of buy-in from the beginning. Next. So kind of within this collaborative kind of educating atmosphere, we really wanted to incorporate ecosystem services, or as we're talking about, benefits from nature. And I would say back in 2012, honestly, internally to our forest, as well as externally to our communities, there really wasn't a lot of understanding about ecosystem services or how to even think about them or talk about them. And so we invited Nicholas Smith to come in from our regional office. She gave us a primer on ecosystem services and then kind of worked alongside of us as we learned kind of ways of expressing benefits from nature in our proposal and in our public presentations. Next. Here's one example. The planner at the local district there, Anita Leach, she put together this diagram to share with the local community. And she kind of pictured it as a house. Under the roof of benefits from nature, you see the three rooms of different types of ecosystem services. I'm going to drop down to the foundation, kind of the underlying processes and functions within the watershed serve as the foundation. And then kind of the floorboards of those human actions, which can have effects to both what's below it and above it. And then probably one of the most important things is that you have community values. It's kind of all balanced. The delivery of these benefits from nature are kind of balanced around the community values. Next. So I want to share one other example from my proposal, our proposal here before I finish. And that's the fact that at the end of our proposal, we have a proposed action table. This is a list of projects that we wanted to roll into NEPA and be able to cover them and do these projects. And what I want to point out is kind of this attempt to show outputs next to outcomes. Outputs are kind of the normal way that we express accomplishment in the Forest Service, and they're quite bland at times. Whereas outcomes can be much richer, and you can kind of show the bigger picture of what's happening when you do this restoration. And then the goal was to tie all of that back to benefits from nature. So in my example there, we wanted to install a bridge to replace an undersized culvert that was limiting fish passage and movement of gravel. And so the output of that is we restore a half mile of stream. Not very meaningful. Outcomes more rich to that are we would remove the only unnatural barrier in an ESA-listed fish stream. We would restore a source of durable gravel to our spawning down below. And we would add genetic diversity to an isolated population of fish, just a much richer outcome. And then the benefits from nature that are affected are wild fish, particularly winter steelhead, traditional cultural uses around that fish, and then the jobs created by the project. Next. So just to finish up here, some of the outcomes from our, it was about a 3-month process. We were able to work with the private industrial on fire protection actions, a lot to do with road access because we collaboratively managed the road system. We worked on wildlife habitat enhancement. We got some volume to the mill, just a really good productive open dialogue with neighbors in the community of interest. And my personal favorite, aquatic restoration. There are now winter steelhead spawning in Soda Fork that were not there before. So huge victory there. Next. That's all I've got. There's my contact information. If anyone's interested in the proposal, just drop me a line. Thanks.
Thank you for that, Johan. We're gonna keep moving here. I'd like to introduce Terry Fairbanks with the Southern Oregon Forest Restoration Collaborative. Welcome, Terry.
Hello. Can you hear me? How's my sound? I'm also.
You sound great.
Good, I'm on satellite as well, and like Will, and I'm just north of Will. This bottom border down here is the California border. We're Southwest Oregon here, and you can see the Cascade Monument. In the middle is Medford. Above that is Ashland, and then to the west is Grants Pass. The area of our interest here is the Rogue Basin, and it's about 3.2 million acres. As you can see, it's a combination of Forest Service lands, the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest, and the Medford BLM. And within that, if there's two main counties, Jackson and Josephine, and to the, which I'm not showing it all the way to the ocean, is Coos County. And so between them all, there's about 330,000 people living in this area. Next slide. So we've got lots of initiatives going on here. And in fact, SOFRIC is involved in a Oregon Watershed Enhancement Board focused investment partnership, about $6 million for 6 years, that we've got like six different projects scattered around the Rogue Basin. And what's guiding us is this Rogue Basin Strategy. It's got a longer name, but that one will do. It's a 20-year plan that's fairly comprehensive and incorporates a lot of the nature benefits messages. And one of the things what I did is divide this leaflet into two parts. We'll look at the next one in a minute. But if you look at the language on this, it's how it's talking to people, I think, is really important. And what it's bringing out is the different things that are really important to this area. As Will explained, for Northern California, we've been inundated with fires and smoke, and people just are almost traumatized by about 2 years ago. We had about 6 weeks of smoke. There was no way you could get away from it. It was everywhere. And but these three things, the wildfire risk mitigation, the restoration, ecological restoration, and then forest and wildland fire management that benefits people and nature. So I think a lot of our messaging is going into how we reach out to people. Next slide, please. And just to continue this, the Rogue Basin Strategy looks at the whole 4 million acres and identifies about 1 million acres of strategic thinning and controlled burning over the next 20 years. And the strategy itself looks at wildfire risk, climate change, wildlife habitat, and then landscape resiliency. And so we take those, there's actually five objectives. There's two kinds of wildfire risk, that which goes close to communities and that which comes from further out in the forest and reaches communities. And we've crafted them into these messages that we think resonate with people. Next slide. So I tried to break down a little bit how we divided our audiences and what I think the messages, how they might vary. And our audiences, and I could put it into one category, general public, but landowners, businesses, our allies and supporters, those are support what we're doing, whether it's fire chiefs or middle of the road conservationists. But we have a lot of support out there. There's fuels groups, there's lots of different organizations working in this area, elected officials, tribal, Latinx, communities at risk. And we've had some success getting the Rogue Basin Strategy incorporated into the Josephine Jackson County Integrated Fire Plan. It's integrated into that. It's integrated into the Medford Water Commission. And this project that we have going on with the Forest Service and BLM, the Rogue Basin Strategy, is the sort of the backbone of it. So I divided the audiences and their messages into kind of three big areas: health and safety, you know, fire risk, smoke, burning in the winter. The cultural, Shakespeare's Festival out of Ashland got inundated. Now it's getting canceled because of COVID. And the cultural is not only recreation, but it's part of this area is outdoor events and the tourism economy that comes into this area. So there's a lot of, we became really aware over the last couple of years of how much forest management itself is affecting the cultural traditions in this area. And then those that are directly tied to forest management, whether it be businesses or counties interested in it, or all the people that work in the woods and care about what's going on out there. There's all of these audiences are interested in that. So next slide. crafting messages, finding that we specialists can get pretty complicated in our messaging and we use a lot of jargon. So it's, I find it very helpful to work with professionals that are good at looking at polls and seeing what resonates with people and keying out your audiences and being very careful about which messages you're directing at which particular audiences. So again, when we go into presentations or we're answering questions, the language is really, really important. And Nature's Benefits, I think, is especially important. Go on to the next slide for the following reasons. You know, it's almost like our populace sort of looked up and said, where is all the smoke coming? I've got to take an interest in this and see why my summer is being ruined and why I'm at risk of my neighborhood burning up. And so there's some just general messaging through the paper and through various kinds of social media that's real important, and people respond to it from a risk and safety and health messaging. Then there's a, as I mentioned earlier, these audiences quite interested in forest management and relationship to fire and aquatic resources. And then the culturals. Go on to the next slide. So I think some of the different ways that Nature Benefits gets worked in to the work we're doing, the tools that we're using is through landscape level analyses, some of the EAs, some of the treatment scheduling. One of our projects used Nature's Benefits and this iterative planning and was quite successful, probably one of the most successful projects in the basin in its outcome. And Nature's Benefits was woven right into it, and there was kind of a consensus community of interest, as the last speaker put it. The other ways are the project activities and field trips. As we all know, those of us who work in the woods, is getting out on a site and looking at a particular project. You can really talk about what the benefits are and what's going on in this particular resource. Climate change adaptation policies. I think Nature's Benefits is really, really important. The other way is briefings and posters. They're all the different ways we're weaving these messages. Last slide. I think the importance of Nature's Benefits is, instead of seeing nature as kind of a backdrop to what people are doing, a lot of people live that way. My neighbors are that way. It's a beautiful landscape out there. They don't understand how the resources come into their lives. And so I think Nature's Benefits makes that clear. And I think that's one of its greatest advantages. And it speaks to the services that are essential to our well-being, whether it's clean air, whether it's resilient forest, fish, water. Individually, we can name them out and make that connection to people between the forest and their lives. And then as a generalization, I find Nature's Benefits comes in as a way to lump all the benefits of people together. And I know that's rather obvious, but I don't know that we had something like that before we started using this more frequently. So I think it's a great shorthand for understanding that we do have a relationship with the forest, that it isn't just we're in the city and they're out. So I think that's, I don't think there's another slide, but I think that's about it, Christiana.
Great, thank you so much, Terry. Up next is Mark Gaston with Lassen National Forest, and he's the public affairs officer there. Welcome.
Good afternoon, everybody. So my presentation is not that long, but I can give you the things that we're doing on the Lassen to kind of get the messaging out about Nature's Benefits. So the first thing is trying to get it out where the audience can see it. So we've been using Twitter and Facebook to do those things. So I just basically take some of the language that's put out in Nature's Benefit, and then I take a picture or something that relates to it, or video or so forth, to relate to the messaging. And then I post it on our social media channels. And so in this particular case, this was Twitter, and it talked about the messaging about water. So it said, did you know that about 2.1 million acre feet of water per year comes from just the Lassen alone, and then over 704 billion gallons per year. So just having a picture, that's Deer Creek River right there, a picture of them. And then with that posting, the next one, Christiana, it showed you that it reached about 1,700 people, and then it has 44 people to engage in that particular post. So that was what was happening on Twitter. Now I want to go to the next slide. This is the same post on Facebook, and it went in and it registered at 2,000 and about 2,100 people. But look at the engagement. We had 267 people who engaged in just that fact alone, and that we could speak to those types of facts and put them out where people could get to them. So that's one of the major ways that Nature's Benefit has been beneficial to our forest. But like my counterparts were saying, ecosystems and fire and things like that, it's important to get that messaging out to the public, and they get a better understanding of what it is that goes on, especially in caring for the land and so forth, whatever. So that's basically what I wanted to bring to you guys, that don't sleep on the messaging that comes out with Nature's Benefits. There's opportunities to post and get the message out about what the document orders and what the facts and stuff that comes out with Nature's Benefits. So that's basically my presentation today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mark. Mm-hmm. We're going to move on to Joe Stubendick, but just a reminder to everyone to submit your questions through the chat feature. Joe is the Recreation Staff Officer at Shasta Trinity National Forest. Welcome, Joe.
All right. Sorry about that, folks. As Christina mentioned, I've been having technical issues so far. But I want to go ahead and talk to you about what Nature's Benefits is to me. So if we go to the next slide. So initially, people might think, hey, what are nature's benefits? You think of water, you think of timber, fishing, wildlife, you know, forest, wind power, things of that nature. But that may be the quick and easy answer. But what I challenge you to do is look at why this is important. So if you go to the next slide. So think back about what got you interested in the outdoors. I know for me, I started as a small kid, and I had three sisters and parents who didn't really like video games and television. So I got outside and I ran away from my sisters, and I had a 800 acre county forest next door in the Mississippi River to get in trouble on and go fishing and all that. So, you know, those experiences rooted me in natural resources and that nature's benefit. So you go to the next slide. This photo you're seeing here is actually my daughter from when we went backpacking this past summer. It was a 3-mile hike. She's a little 5-year-old girl, and she got out there and we had a backpack on her and she had a blast. And everything that we did it slowed way down and at, the pace of a 5-year-old kid, as opposed to, you know, a bigger hike, a bigger trip and all that. And, it's something that she still talks about today. She brings it up quite a bit, and it's one of those things that a little bit of effort can go a long ways to plant that seed. So if you go to the next slide, please. And so as part of that and recognizing that, I think that nature's benefit is fantastic if we have it and we have it now, but ultimately if our public doesn't value what nature has for us, those values won't be protected and won't be preserved and seen as a good thing. So we work with numerous different entities and different ways to try and get that information out, working with, you know, really thinking about who our public is. And, you know, I chose children on this one right now because whatever we value now doesn't matter, because the kids are going to have that vote, that say, and that shift in our, you know, our view of things. So we work with our campground concessionaire to pass this along. We stress it with our seasonal workforce, our front desk operations. We work with volunteers and partner groups. Specifically, we do a fish painting event at the county fair, and we paint fish out of t-shirts. And kids, you know, that's what they see. They think of the Forest Service, and they think of what, you know, there is. And it's a kids fishing day where we teach kids how to fish. And we have a bald eagle program where we teach them about the food web and help plant grasses in our lake bed so that we can build fish habitat and things like that. And then, you know, Mark had touched on it before. And I will say that social media. It's one of those things that it seems odd to think about how we're talking about nature's benefit, but realistically, that's the way people see things, and they ingest things via social media now. So even though it's on a screen, it's really important that we get that word out. So if you go to the next slide, please. And I apologize, it looks like this one didn't get quite finished up. But, you know, just remember that kids are the future advocates of our open spaces and natural places. If they don't value nature's benefits, future policy will reflect that lack of value. I think I can't stress it enough that the kids' interaction today and it being a positive one goes a long ways to build that future group of citizens that want to use our natural spaces. So that's kind of what I've got. I hope that it was helpful for folks. And that's all I've got.
Thanks, Joe. We're going to get to our Q&A here. We've got questions rolling in. This first one I'm going to direct to Johan and Joe. How did you work with your communications shop / public affairs office to share information with different stakeholders, including internal communications with all employees?
I'll go first on that one. So ours was a pretty discrete time period of a few months. Public affairs kind of worked with us on putting out press releases for public meetings, some social media, and then when we finished our proposal, they helped us kind of distribute that to different places and put it in a place where folks could access it. That would be my answer.
Sure. So this is Joe again. I would say that I guess every day that we're in the office and doing work, we need to be thinking about what is it that we're doing and how does that look public facing? And so as we're doing our work, we're trying to make sure that everything we're doing can be posted on the web. And then when we hit something that looks like it'd be a good thing, to put it out there. And, you know, I think doing that more frequently is better than not frequently enough. We need to slow down and plug that stuff. We recently pulled a car out of the lake that was really helpful to get that one out there, showing the hard work. And, you know, it got a ton of hits in terms of people seeing the good work that we're doing out there. So I would say just kind of take time to do it because it's an extra step that you don't have to do, but it makes a big difference in the long run.
Great. Thank you. I see we have a bit of traffic on the chat. Terry, would you please share with us what you mentioned about the professional marketing company? I think you might be muted. Let's see.
There. I've got two places that I mute. Yes, I just shared some answers. The company has worked with collaboratives in Oregon. The Deschutes CFLRP might be the most well-known example. And then there's been some other their name's Bold and Ampersand out of Bend, Oregon. And it's been kind of an exciting process. We just got started with it. And they really are professionals. They know what they're doing. You know, what might take us a week to figure out, they lead us through in an hour or two in terms of figuring out our audiences, how we see ourselves, developing a single kind of an identity. We'll probably work a little bit on logo, you know, and we're just getting started. So, and we're tackling a very big area and we have a lot of people in different kinds of audiences. So we almost had to do something like this, you know, what would have took the whole 20 years of the strategic plan probably would have took us to figure it out. Hopefully we'll get a start on it. We'll communicate and we'll be a little more successful.
Thanks, Terry. I'm going to direct this question to Mark. Mark, how do you maintain effective communication across a large landscape like a national forest?
Okay. Sometimes that can be challenging, but knowing who your audience is and your subject matter experts, it's all about getting them excited about what it is that you want to convey to the public with them. And so, like most of my counterparts have mentioned, doing communication plans and things like that are an effective way to get the messaging out to the audience. I was surprised to find out how much the audience and the community want to know about natural resources and what contribution they can play to being successful and making projects success, bringing success to the projects and stuff like that. So, getting that messaging across, letting people know how their projects affect the audience, and then resonating off of the excitement that comes from the results from the project. That's the best way to convey those messages. And then just like Joe said, social media is the way to go. So that's how I would address that particular question. And ask everybody to, you know, communicate with your public affairs group and let them know what it is that you're trying to convey and see if they have ideas to help you incorporate them and get them out to your audience. So those are some of my tips for you.
And thank you, Mark. Mm-hmm. Let's see,
Could I add on to that one?
Yes, please, Joe.
So one of the things I was just gonna say about the social media, is just be careful what you wish for. Sometimes we've had situations where we've identified a, you know, particular waterfall hike that's a beautiful place to go. And instead of having, you know, 10 visitors over the weekend, it has 150 visitors over the weekend. And so just be prepared to, you know, scale up your management of those areas if you need to, because that can happen and it can catch you by surprise.
Good point. Thanks, Joe. I know there's a publication here, Portland Monthly, will publish like secret swimming holes, and people don't like it when they do that because then everybody knows
no longer
they are. They're not a secret anymore. Okay, there's a question. Do any of the speakers know how their communications are resonating with their audiences? And I saw, Will, you had put an answer in the chat there. Would you mind speaking about that?
Yeah, I think the proof is in the pudding when it comes to, you know, our partnerships, our collaboratives, our proposing projects and implementing projects that are directly affecting our communities. And I think the sign that our messaging is working is that the people that are being affected by our work are see the value in it and support the project. And so just an example, you know, 10 years ago, the type of work that we're doing right now, doing, you know, several prescribed burns, 20 to 30 prescribed burns within fire season in the fall, right around communities, putting smoke into town, you know, the acceptance of that practice, because people know that not only is their community going to be more fire safe, but there's also going to be, you know, cultural resources coming from that burn, you know, acorns that don't have bugs, grasslands, they're going to support wildlife, and better stream function, you know, because we're taking more straws out of the streams to get more in-stream water during summer base flows. So all that messaging over time has greatly increased our support for those practices that we're proposing to change process. You know, it's really, I think that one of the things that we've really tried to focus on is that, you know, single species management may not get us there. It's how we have affected our processes, you know, the fire process, the water flow process that is affecting all species. And so I think that kind of messaging about how we can understand our human effect on the landscape and start to address, you know, how we can restore those natural processes and work with those natural processes to make positive change.
Great, thank you. I'm gonna direct this question to Terry. Did taking a nature's benefits approach to planning or understanding the landscape help you advance your management goals for that area? If no, why not? If yes, in what ways?
Yeah, I think they really do. And I think John really kind of spoke to this very eloquently in terms of communities of interest and being in at the very beginning of projects. We have a long ways to go here in the Rogue Basin to do that, but we've got some good examples now where folks really did bring in what was important to them, what their values were, what they were comfortable with and what they weren't. And as that sort of iterative approach worked its way through, a plan that a lot of people could adapt, could believe in, could support, came into being. And it's contrasted with a lot of other projects we have in this basin where that hasn't happened. And then there's some kind of in the middle where folks are pretty comfortable with what's going on, but felt like they weren't part of the process. So we've got the whole range of planning, and the way nature's benefits were worked into that one project we did, the Upper Applegate, which is in an adaptive management area, was the language it used was really quite good in how it brought together how folks felt about the landscape. That's the only way I can describe it. Might be worth taking a look at the Upper Applegate Watershed Project, but they did a nice way of bringing in people's values, what was important to them, and where on the landscape these things would occur.
Thank you, Terry. This next question is for anyone, but I'm gonna suggest Johan first. What challenges did you face in addressing nature's benefits in your process or messaging? How did you address those challenges, or what lessons learned did you take away from those difficulties?
Yeah, so in my case, I think it was just being new to the whole communication of those nature's benefits. And so how do you boil it down to something that folks can very quickly and easily understand in a PowerPoint slide and a discussion at a meeting? I think that was the biggest challenge, but I think our group was just creative, and we just spent time thinking and talking and throwing ideas out. And you know, that diagram of the house that I showed you guys, we didn't end up putting it into the proposal itself, but it just really helped our thinking as a group, and then just helped us communicate to the outside community. Wanted to tack on a little bit to that last question, just to mention something that we did with our process was to really honor the history of the private industrial that we were working with. The Hill Family Foundation owns the land and for a long time has had it managed to benefit not only the family, but the local community. There was a lot of community emphasis there. And we were able to kind of put a timeline on with not only Forest Service, but Hill Family Trust over the last 100 years, just kind of demonstrate the history, because I think history is really important to local people. So I just wanted to bring that up.
Thanks, Johan. Does anyone else have a lesson learned about addressing challenges, nature's benefits in your process or messaging?
Yeah,
All right. Well, with that, I'd just like to let you know that this was the third webinar in the Nature's Benefits Forum series. We've had one a week during the month of May, and our final installment is next week, where we'll learn how to use storytelling to leverage nature's benefits. You can visit willamettepartnership.org/naturesbenefits. My colleague Emily just dropped the link into the chat if you want to follow it there. You can learn more and register for the final session in the series. We'll also post a recording of each webinar on that page. If you missed one or you'd like to share it with a colleague, go ahead on head on over to the website and check it out. Thank you so much to Mark, Will, Joe, Johan, and Terry, and to each of you for being here today. We look forward to seeing you next week. Take care.